Good morning and welcome back to our macroeconomic session. Now, so far we have studied the current account, capital account, working of BOP, and we have moved towards understanding the foreign exchange rates. Now, many of you had this doubt about reserve transactions. The official reserve transaction is nothing but the movement in the reserves of the country whenever the BOP does not tally. Correct? It involves the sale and purchase. We had heard the open market operation in case of RBI. This is something very similar to that. Official reserve transactions are the transactions in official reserves of a country. Now, what are the official reserves? It is the stock of foreign exchange that we have. Correct? So, when the transactions or fluctuations occur in official reserves of a country by the government itself, it is termed as official reserves. Now, I also asked you to do an assignment in which I asked you what type of movements occur in official reserves when there is a BOP deficit and what happens when there is a BOP surplus. So, what you have to understand is when there is a deficit means the receipts are less and the payments are more. Means the outflow is more and the inflow is less. So, what are you going to do is you are going to withdraw from your for official reserves, the foreign exchange, and you're going to sell that foreign exchange. So in case of deficit, there is a sale so that the receipts will come in and it will tally. The balance of payments will tally. And if there is a surplus, you have the excess money. What are you going to do is you are going to deposit. Means you are going to purchase the foreign exchange and deposit it in your country. Okay. So what do you have to remember? When there is a BOP deficit, the official reserve transactions, what movement occur in official reserve transaction is that the foreign exchange is withdrawn, or you can say sell of foreign exchange, and when there is a surplus, there is a purchase of foreign exchange. Okay. So now today we are going to start with our first method of determining the exchange rate, that is the flexible exchange rate. Now, before we move into understanding the flexible exchange rate, understand that India is following the flexible exchange rate, right? Because we are a sort of open economy, and in our international trade system, what happens is the market forces of demand and supply, the fluctuations in the bullion market or the fluctuations in the trade market, all these things are considered together in order to determine the foreign exchange rate. Okay, so here are two figures which show the market forces of demand and supply. Now, in microeconomics, it was very easy for us to understand the concepts of demand and supply. But in foreign exchange, what you have to understand, whenever you say demand and supply, you are not talking about the demand and supply of goods or services. You are talking about the demand and supply of foreign exchange itself, means the foreign currency, let's say the US dollars, right? We studied all the factors related to demand and supply yesterday. So we know that demand and price have negative relationship. So it will slope downwards, and supply of foreign exchange and the price of foreign exchange means rupee per dollar has a positive relationship. So supply curve will slope or rise upwards. Correct? So whatever is the price at which the demand and supply for foreign exchange is the same becomes your rate for today. Correct? So today, if say, let's say the rate is 70 rupees or 70.60 rupees, whatever it is, even in decimal also, that rate is the rate at which the demand for your US dollars and supply of the US dollars is the same, or you can say for the INR is the same. Correct? So this is called as your equilibrium forex. This is your rate for today. Okay, so I am not interested in telling you how this equilibrium works and everything. I want to tell you the practical approach, right? You know how is equilibrium formed. Equilibrium is when demand and supply intersect. This we have been learning since last 1 year, correct? So now what we have to see is how does the demand of a particular currency affect the rate. Okay, when I say, let's say for example, there is a cure of this COVID-19 in, let's say, US has found the cure, the vaccine for it. So what will happen? not due to the change in price, but due to change in these other factors, like you can say this COVID-19 vaccine, what is going to happen? Now you want more and more US currency because you want to purchase that vaccine for yourself. So what is going to happen? The demand, like I told you yesterday, outflow. You want to import that vaccine, so you need to have the purchasing power in order to purchase that vaccine. So the demand increases. Whenever you say demand increases, demand curve shifts to the right. This is your microeconomics term which is coming here. Because in the first chapter itself, we saw that in macroeconomics, there is a general equilibrium, means everything depends on everything else. So when I say there is an increase in demand, what is happening is the demand curve will shift to the right, DD1, because now we will want more and more currency, means the quantity that was here will now, you see, the new equilibrium that you have achieved is here. This is blue line is your new equilibrium. Q1 means you want more and more forex in order to purchase that vaccine. But when you are increasing the demand, or when you are thinking that the demand should be more, then what happens to the price? Because we are interested in determining the foreign exchange rate. So we are very much keen to understand that what happens to the price itself. As you can see, if this is your new equilibrium, then the corresponding price will obviously be higher. Now, why did I say obviously be higher? Because in case the demand is more, what happens is whatever product has more demand, means uski value thodi badh jati hai. Correct? So the price also increases. When there is more demand, when the demand rises, the price will also rise. Now here we are not trying to establish a relationship between the price and the demand, but we are trying to identify the reasons or the consequences of what happens to your demand due to other factors, not due to price. So when the demand shifts to the right, correct? When the demand shifts to the right, the prices increase no matter what. And prices increase, what does it mean? That now you have to pay more rupee for getting that $1. Now you have to exchange more Indian rupees in order to get the same one amount of US dollars. And that is the entire thing. Now whichever country comes up with the vaccine is going to rise its price. The value of that country is going to become more in the international market. So whenever the demand shifts to the right, means when there is an increase in demand due to whatever factor it may be, the exchange rate or the price of foreign exchange, as we call it, also increases. Now in this situation, what will happen? Will our country become more and more attractive, or will the foreign country become more and more attractive? What is happening due to only this COVID vaccine reason? It may be the only reason why this is happening, but it is going to affect the entire economy. Now we are happening to pay more prices. We are happening to exchange more and more Indian rupee for the same US dollar. So our market has become cheaper. Our currency has depreciated. So what is happening is now it is advisable for us to export more, because we are becoming attractive. People will want to invest, right? So whatever happens due to, even if one reason you have for this situation going right here, it will affect the entire economy. And by the by, you have to, you know, keep repeating this to yourself, that if the prices increase, what happens? You have to pay more. If you have to pay more for the same quantity, means the value of your currency, the domestic currency, means the Indian rupee, is going on decreasing. If it is going on decreasing, means the value is depreciating. If it is depreciating, your market, your domestic market, is becoming attractive, means people are more interested. So you can use this opportunity and export as much as possible. Okay, so as you can see, the equilibrium is what? Shifting. It is rising, so price is also rising, and the quantity supplied or quantity demanded is also rising. Right here, as you saw, the supply, there is no change in supply, but due to rise in demand, the quantity is also shifting to the right. Now another example right over here. Now we will see what happens if the supply shifts. I think you are having a little deja vu. We studied this thing in 11th standard also, when there is a shift in supply curve and no change in demand, or when there is a shift in demand curve, no change in supply, and then the simultaneous shift. Everything works the same way only. It is not a rocket science. Again, I am telling you, it is very easy. If you go slowly, step by step, when you go, you will figure it out yourself. Okay? So what happens if the supply is increasing? Why will the supply increase? If I say supply is increasing, again I have to shift it to the right. Correct? If I am shifting it to the right, what is the reason for increase in supply? Like I told you, if demand is the currency that you need for outflow, supply is the currency that you need for inflow. If some country is, interested in your country in order to invest, or the direct investment or say portfolio investment is increasing from the outsiders, it will lead to what? Increase in supply. So this is increasing. So what is happening? When supply is increasing, you can say there is excess supply going over here. There is excess supply going on here, but there is no change in the demand. So what is the new equilibrium that you get? Even if the quantity is increasing, because we are saying increase in supply means the quantity has to increase, but the prices, what happens to the prices? This was the original equilibrium price. This is your P1. So you can see that it is going down. Means what is happening? When there is excess supply, what will happen? The prices will decrease. Prices will decrease means now your market is attractive, means you are becoming more valuable now. When you are becoming valuable, what is happening? Your market is attractive. But the foreign exchange rate, what happens to foreign exchange rate is it declines. Why does it decline? When there is a excess supply, what happens during excess supply? That you have more to invest than what is being demanded. Then what will happen? In order to attract that demand, in order to make us to export the goods, what will happen is the exchange rates will decrease. Correct? So if the exchange rates are decreasing, now we will also be attracted in the foreign market. We will also import those goods and we will also supply the foreign exchange to them. So when there is an increase in supply, what happens is when you say demand is outflow, then supply is inflow. You want the foreign exchange to enter into your country. But what is happening? In order to attract that supply, you will have to lower your prices. Or if the supply is also getting attracted, your market is suddenly very attractive. Everybody will come in and try to, use this opportunity, and ultimately then you will become unattractive and the prices are bound to fall. Okay, so as we saw, when the demand rises, the prices also tend to rise. But what happens when supply rises? The demand tends to fall. This is simple. What we learned in 11th standard, when there is an excess demand, there is more demand, it leads to inflation, means price rise. When there is more supply, excess supply, when there is supply, you want to supply, but you also want to create demand, because your supply is more than the demand. Right here, your supply is more, but the demand does not change, means your supply is increasing irrespective of change in demand. So at that time, what you have to do is you have to lower your prices so the currency appreciates. Okay, when the prices increases, the currency depreciates, and when the prices decreases, the currency appreciates. Okay, this is the entire working of our flexible exchange rate system. You can also try doing this by changing both the things simultaneously, both the demand curve. You can try changing it in opposite directions. This all will give you an insight into how the foreign exchange rate is actually determined. Okay, so this is all for our flexible exchange rate system. Let's move to the fixed exchange rate system. fixed exchange rate system. What is fixed exchange rate system? Fixed exchange rate system is the system in which the government or the monetary authorities like the central bank of the country determine or they fix a particular exchange rate, and this exchange rate is fixed for a longer period of time until they develop new policies. Correct? So what happens in fixed exchange rate system is the government, according to their own economic position, according to the position of their country in the foreign exchange market, let's say the international market, and also with consultation with the World Bank, what it does, it determines a particular exchange rate. Like I will say, if government today decides that one US dollar should be exchanged for rupees 75. This is their own decision. So all the players in the market, all the countries trading with that particular economy have to follow this fixed exchange rate system. But as the name only suggests, it is fixed. But when the US also determines the same exchange rate, then it is a tie. So that is called as the pegging. Both the countries, you know, come into a mutual understanding and they determine one exchange rate, that is the pegged exchange rate, which is nothing but fixed exchange rate. But this fixed exchange rate is currently having lesser and lesser value. Nobody is adopting this fixed exchange rate for obvious reasons that it is not possible. The economy is so dynamic that you cannot work in a rigid environment. If you say you have to exchange it for 75 and tomorrow, if say our country only develops the vaccine for COVID-19, what will happen? In spite of us being more valuable currently, but we will not be able to, you know, gain the benefits out of it because the exchange rate is fixed. When it is fixed, I am not saying it is fixed for, like say, forever. But yes, for a considerably long period of time, let's say, maybe with the shifts of government, the exchange rates will shift. But the exchange rate remains constant for a longer period of time. And this is the most important drawback of fixed exchange rate. That is why this fixed exchange rate system is currently getting wiped off from the system. But flexible exchange rate system is for economies which are independent, which are, you know, mixed economy. Socialist may be economy, capitalist may be economy. But what happens in socialist economy is this fixed exchange rate system. As we saw in the socialist economy, government has more interference. Government has the major say. So obviously, the thing that they are going to do for the international trade is they are going to determine their own exchange rate, and that is your fixed exchange rate. Like I said, it is getting wiped off, but why is it still in your syllabus? Because it is still relevant to the socialist economies at large. Even if we do not have a pure socialist as such, but then there are countries in which socialist economic systems still exist and they follow the fixed exchange rate system. Now, there is not much to it, so we will move forward with understanding what is the managed floating. Managed floating is the third type of your determination of foreign exchange rate. Managed floating is also called as dirty floating, and it is a combination of your fixed and flexible exchange rate system. Now, why is this managed floating? Why is the need for a third type of system to develop the foreign exchange rate or to determine the foreign exchange rate? It is because all those two systems that we studied have their own drawbacks, right? Like flexible exchange rate system, it is okay if you theoretically learn it. But what happens in practical life is the exchange rate is determined so frequently, it is changed so frequently that the long-term policies formation for government becomes very difficult, right? With every day the market demand and supply forces go on changing. Anything happens in the US, the foreign exchange changes. Anything happens in India, the foreign exchange rate changes. So this becomes very difficult for a government to frame policies which have a long-term effect, which have an insight of long-term planning. So the thing is that if we leave totally purely up to the flexible exchange rate system, it is going to have so frequent fluctuation that economy cannot be stabilized. For that purpose, we introduce you to the managed floating system. Now, as the word indicates, it is managed floating. Like, suppose the market demand and supply intersect at, let's say, rupees 75. Okay, so that 75 rupees becomes what? Your foreign exchange rate. But in that foreign exchange rate, what happens is, if some changes are made in a country's economic structure, let's say US or let's say India, and suddenly the value of your currency goes on depreciating. Now, if there is too much of depreciation, then even the exports cannot yield you any benefit. Even if there is so much depreciation that the value of your INR is going beyond the point that is reasonable, what will happen is your economy will suffer through a crisis. I'll just give you an example. Let's say, if I say today $1, as I told you, the economy or the market forces are giving you 75 rupees for $1, and then what happens, the market value starts decreasing so far that, let's say, it is about to reach like the 85 or let's say 90, whatever, means it is, the downfall is too much. And then we are moving towards what? Economic crisis, because 10 rupee per US dollar, you are paying 10 rupees extra for $1. And if it goes on continue, you may be wiped off from the international economy. So here what happens is the government comes into playing the role. Right? The government or the RBI, the ultimate financiers of our system, come and do something which will help the country from getting wiped off, or which will help the country in order to retain their own exchange rate. Right? So that system or that thought which the government has of making change in the foreign exchange rate, that is your main managed or managed floating or dirty floating, correct? So when the market forces are determined, when the exchange rate is determined by the market forces, but in certain cases where the government feels it's not apt and the government comes into play a part, play a role, that is called as the managed floating. So what does the government do? Two things that the government does is devaluation and revaluation. When you say devaluation, you mean the government itself deliberately, jaan boojh ke, it comes and it does something which decreases the value of domestic currency in the international market. Now you will say, why would a government decrease the value of its own currency in the international market? Because if the currency depreciates, there is a much more attractiveness for your domestic market. Let's say, for example, there is a country in which your sales are not going much, or that country is not much interested in your country, but you want to expand your exports and you really want to get into trade with that particular country. So what you have to do in order to attract the demand for that country, what you have to do is lower your prices, but the market forces still is increasing your prices. What you will do is devaluation. The government of your country will devalue your currency, means it is same, the exchange rates will be higher, means devaluation, correct? The depreciation and devaluation on the graph mean the same thing, that the prices are going up. But in practical life, the depreciation has no role of government. It is purely through the market mechanism. But devaluation is a mechanism of your managed floating in which government deliberately lowers the value of the domestic currency in international market in order to expand their international trade, or let's say in order to expand their exports. And then when this exports goes on expanding and suddenly your market is again here getting on the verge of collapse, then government will do something which is called as revaluation. It will increase the value of your rupee in the international market, means let's say reverse. Today, after increasing the exports, what is happening? 85 rupees is the limit, and then through market forces again you find that it will go on increasing more and more. So government will come and it will revalue your currency, thereby pegging it at 75. You can't really say the word pegging, but yes, it will come and revalue your currency at rupees 75 per US dollars. So this will help in what? Keeping the economy in a stabilized position, right? So when you are talking about flexible exchange rate system, then what happens to your currency or the exchange rate system is the depreciation or appreciation. But when you are talking about managed floating, the government or the RBI will only come and intervene when the market forces are unfavorable, or let's say when the government wants to do something in terms of formulating policies for international trade. At that time, it will deliberately attempt doing something as devaluation, wherein it will reduce the value of its own country's currency, and revaluation, which is complete total opposite of it. Correct? So these are the systems of our foreign exchange rate system. That will be all for today. Thank you.